Remain standing as we sing our hymns of praise, Come Thou Almighty King, number 71, and Lord of the Sabbath, number 393.
Our Father, all glory. As far as possible, let's all kneel as we seek the Lord in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your grace, for your mercy, and for your forgiveness. Father, we are all sinners, and we have no right to heaven if not for Christ. Lord, we want to remember the group that is attending the health talks every Monday. Father, we know that thy Spirit will come and convict hearts and bring them to you. We want to pray for our church, Father. We know that we've sinned. Some of us might not even have done the things that we want to do or expected to do. Father, thy Holy Spirit convicts, and we pray that you search our hearts, that whatever we do in church and in every aspect of our lives, that we do it desiring for the good of others, not for ourselves. Lord, you set us an example. Follow. We pray that that will always be in our hearts, and we will always be guided by the Spirit to do it right. Father, there are times we are in the last days. We are seeing many things happening around us, and we know you will be coming soon. There are those that have yet to know you, especially those that are close to us. Some who have known and then have left. We pray for them. We pray for our children. We pray for our loved ones, our husband and our wives, our parents, those that are dear to us. Father, may thy Holy Spirit convict. Bring them back, Lord. And if we can be a good witness for you, use us. Father, we know that sometimes even our own lives is not right. We pray that you forgive us as well. We pray that we'll always not be a stumbling block to the people around us, at work, at home, anywhere else. Father, we want to pray for the Singaporeans. Many are fearing for this disease, this sickness that's flying around, Zika. We know that your will be done for everyone. And those who are facing health challenges, may we have the faith, may they have the faith as well, to hold dear to your promises and to trust you in whatever happens to our lives. Father, help us, strengthen us, grant us courage that will move mountains. We live all our lives into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I'd like you guys to open your Bibles and turn with me to Mark chapter 12, 41 to 44. Right, Mark chapter 12, 41 reads, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on." As I was trying to think of new ways to appeal, you know, to give offering and tithe, right? Because every week someone always comes up here and appeals to us to give generously, give without, you know, selfishness. I was looking for new ways to say it because we've heard it all before, right? So as I was looking through the whole of last night, I found out that there wasn't any new way of saying it, right? It's all the same, right? Give because it's not ours to begin with, right? Give back to what he is owed. Give with a willing heart, with a loving heart. And the thing is, that's a good thing that I couldn't find anything new, because as human beings, we forget all the time. We forget how lucky we are, right? We forget our blessings. We forget that we are so much more fortunate than so many others. When I was reading this verse, it really jumped out at me because it talked about this woman who had almost nothing. And still, she gave everything because she remembered the love that she had for Jesus. She remembered what Jesus had done for her, and she knew, she had faith that it was going to happen again. So she gave. And I think that should be something that we should all remember. Every single week they come here and appeal to us, and it's, you know, it's a bit boring, right? It's a bit bland. They do it over and over again, but we need to be reminded to give lovingly, unselfishly. To give because we already have so much. Even when we don't have anything, that is still more than some people have. So let's give, even if we feel that we cannot. Because we were given first. I'd like to invite the deacons to stand up as we pray. Let's pray. Dear Father in Heaven, I'd like to thank you, Lord, for bringing us here today. I'd like to ask that you constantly remind us, Lord, that we, of your glory, of your love, of the wealth that you have given us in our lives, the love, the relationships, Lord. We forget. And we thank you so much for constantly reminding us and loving us, even when we do forget. I'd like to ask all this in Jesus' name, Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Hi children, can you come in front? We have children's story today. Okay, so today I'm going to tell you a story of this man called Jonah. This is Jonah. Now, Jonah has a very special task because one day God told Jonah to go to a place called Nineveh and tell the people there to repent. Now, what do you think Jonah did? Did Jonah go to Nineveh? No, Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. Instead, Jonah decided that I shall run all the way to a place called Tarshish. Tarshish is all the way there. And he didn't want to do what God asked him to do. So now, back in those days, there's no such thing as an airplane, and the fastest way would be to go there by ship. So that's what Jonah did, and he took a ship to Tarshish. Now, on his way there, God sent a really big storm. And the storm was so huge, the ship was about to be broken. Now, the people were very afraid. And then they started throwing out everything they could see on the boat to try to save themselves. And they even started to pray to their own gods. But what about Jonah? What do you think Jonah was doing? Yeah, Jonah was all the way at the bottom of the ship, sleeping. So now everyone finally found Jonah and they said, "Why are you sleeping? Go call on your God and maybe he will save us and we will not die." So after a while, the people realized that this storm was connected to Jonah. And Jonah told them that, yes, this is happening because of me, because I'm running away from my God. And so they grew very afraid. And then Jonah told the people, "Why don't you just throw me over into the sea? Just do that, because this storm is all because of me." But the people were actually reluctant to do that at first, and they just tried very hard to row to Tarshish, but the storm just grew bigger and bigger. So in the end, Jonah was finally thrown into the sea. And when Jonah was thrown into the sea, a big fish came and swallowed Jonah up. So a big fish started swimming to Jonah and swallowed him up. So Jonah spent 3 days and nights in the belly of this fish. And during these 3 days and nights, he spent his time praying to God. Now, finally, Jonah was at peace with what God was telling him to do. And so not long after that, the fish vomited Jonah up in Nineveh. So now Jonah is at Nineveh. And this time round, God told Jonah again, "Go tell the people of Nineveh to repent." And this time round, Jonah did. So what can we learn from Jonah? Well, sometimes maybe God will tell us things we might not like to do, or maybe we don't understand why he's asking us to do it. But no matter what the choice we make, like in Jonah's case, he decided to run away, the experience is never wasted. God can still use us. So thank you for listening to the story. Something for you guys. Okay, so I hope you all remember the story of Jonah. You guys can go back to your seats now.
For scripture reading this morning, we are reading from the book of Judges, chapter 9, verse 22 to 25. Judges chapter 9, verse 22 to 25. Now, Abimelech ruled over Israel 3 years. Then God sent an evil spirit between Abimelech and the men of Shechem. And the men of Shechem dealt treacherously with Abimelech, so that the violence done to the 70 sons of Jerubbaal might come, and their blood might be laid on Abimelech their brother, who killed them, and on the men of Shechem, who strengthened his hands to kill his brothers. The men of Shechem set men in ambush against him on the tops of the mountains, and they robbed all who might pass by them along the road. And it was told to Abimelech. May the Lord bless the reading of his words.
Good morning and a happy Sabbath. We are continuing our series on the book of Judges. And today we study about Abimelech. Just a qualification. Abimelech is not one of the judges. But yet, the account of his story spanned over the chapter 9. In fact, chapter 9 was the longest chapter talking about him. He is the son of Gideon through his concubine. Abimelech means, my father is the king. Let's recap what happened after the victorious expedition of overcoming the Midianites, soldiers, and the eastern tribes. We see Gideon was really human. As you can see, he was asking food from a city, but they refused to give him. So in the end, he said, if you don't give me any food, I will punish you. So he punished those elders who refused to support him in his military expedition. Apparently, he was a harsh dictator during that time. And then after the victorious expedition against the Midianites, he asked for a reward from every soldier, a golden earring. And he made a 20 kilo, they pronounce as ephod, or the Hebrew word will be ephod. And people worship this image that was set up. Let's recap. Gideon made the gold into an ephod, which he placed in Ophrah, his town. And all Israel prostituted themselves by worshipping it there. And it became a snare to Gideon and his family. And one of the lessons that we can learn from Gideon is that we must be careful that what we establish as traditions and practices in our families and churches. Do not carry within them the seeds of our descendants' destruction. And clearly, our legacy to others includes not only our strength, but also our weaknesses as well. So therefore, we must be careful to live with integrity before them. Obviously, Gideon, in his later life, had planted many seeds for his descendants' future destruction. And one of the greatest thorn in his flesh was his son. If you recall, many of the Israelites said, God use you, or you are the one who have helped us, who has freed us from the Midianites' rule. Why don't you rule over us? Be our king. Gideon said, no, the Lord will be your king. But then through the years, he lived like a king, and his 70 sons lived like kings. And he named the concubine's son Abimelech. My father is the king, referring to he is the king. And then when Gideon passed away, after 40 years of peace, Abimelech gathered his mother's relatives. By the way, the mother's relatives were Canaanites. He said, which is better for you, to have 70 of Jeroboam's sons rule over you, or just one man, that is me? Remember, I'm your flesh and blood. And what he did? He went to his father's home in Ophrah, and on one stone, murdered his 70 brothers, the sons of Jeroboam, which is Gideon. But Jotham, the youngest son of Jerubbaal, escaped by hiding. So can you imagine? Just because Gideon have made this terrible mistake, his entire family, almost his entire family, was wiped out. Remember how Gideon got his name, Jerubbaal? Jerubbaal means let Baal contend with him. And indeed, initially Gideon succeeded in overcoming the worshippers of Baal. But then Baal won the victory. The worshippers of Baal wanted to kill Gideon, but then the father said, If Baal is so strong, let Baal contend with him. That's how he got his name, Jerubbaal. Jerubbaal means let Baal contend with him. So what happened was, funds were taken from the temple of Baal to hire professional killers to kill Gideon's 70 sons. So professional killers were those troublemakers. So how much was taken? The Bible told us in chapter 9. 70 pieces of silver were raised through that temple of Baal to hire professional killers to kill the 70 sons. Ophrah, where Gideon knocked down the temple of Baal, his entire line wiped out as an act of revenge by the worshippers of Baal. So this is the sign of the triumph of Abimelech, the man of Shechem, or Shechem, over the people of Israel. As you can see, God's people gained the victory in part one. Now in part two, Satan's instrument got an upper hand. And the great controversy theme between Christ and Satan is played out in the story of Abimelech. The youngest son of Gideon escaped. His name is Jotham. So the whole countrymen of Shechem gather in one place to crown Abimelech as king. While they were doing so, Jotham climbed up on the mountain and started to shout to them. He preached a message. He gave a parable. What was the parable? Let's turn to the Bible, shall we? To the book of Judges. The book of Judges is after Deuteronomy, after the book of Joshua, and then Judges. Judges chapter 9, verse 7. When Jotham was told about this, he climbed up on top of the Mount Gerizim and shouted to them, "Listen to me, citizens of Shechem, so that God may listen to you. One day the trees went out to anoint a king for themselves. They say to the olive tree, 'Be our king.' But the olive tree answered, 'Should I give my oil? Should I give up my oil? By both gods and men are honored to hold sway over the trees.' Next, the tree said to the fig tree, 'Come and be our king.' But the fig tree replied, 'Should I give up my fruit, so good and sweet, to hold sway over the trees?' Then the tree said to the vine, 'Come and be our king.' But the vine answered, 'Should I give up my wine, which cheers both gods and men, to hold sway over the trees?' Finally, all the trees said to the thorn bush," the thorn bush is a useless shrub, "'Come and be our king.' The thorn bush said to the trees, 'If you really want to anoint me king over you, come and take refuge in my shade. But if not, then let fire come out of the thorn bush and consume the cedars of Lebanon.'" And he went on to say, "Now, if you have acted honorably and in good faith when you make Abimelech king, and if you have been fair to Jerubbaal and his family, and if you have treated him as he deserves, and to think that my father fought for you, risked his life to rescue you from the hands of Midian, but today you have revolted against my father's family, murdered his 70 sons on a single stone, and make Abimelech, the son of the slave girl, king over the citizens of Shechem because of your brother, if then you have acted honorably and in good faith towards Jerubbaal and his family today, may Abimelech be your joy, and may you be his too. But if you have not, let fire come out of Abimelech and consume you, citizens of Shechem and Beth Milo. And let fire come out from you, citizens of Shechem and Beth Milo, and consume Abimelech." So Jotham preached this parable of the trees, olive tree, fig tree, and the vine. These three trees rejected the offer to be king. But then the thorn bush. These three trees refer to the brothers, to his brothers. These 70 brothers were honorable. They refused to be king. They say each of them can perform their duty and need not be king. They can be leaders, but not king. They can be useful in other things. But the thorn bush, the useless thorn bush, when finally it came to him, he said, "Okay, I can be your king. Come to me. But you must obey me. If you don't obey me, you will be killed." And that is the parable. Four trees all talking about accepting Abimelech as king. Olive rejected superficial power. Fig, spirit of love, it has, rejects the offer. Vine, inner peace amidst pain that it can offer, reject. Bramble, a thorny plant, accepts. And Jotham say, "If you think you guys are doing the right thing by making him king, good. But if you have acted unfairly to Gideon, Jotham pronounced a curse. Abimelech was king for 3 years. And under his kingship, he ruled Israel and Shechem with a heavy hand. And because of his cruelty, God sent an evil spirit among the citizens of Shechem. So these people became very unhappy with Abimelech. And what did they do? The citizens of Israel, or foreigners who give tribute to Abimelech, these citizens of Shechem gather and ambush these people. And it happened day and night. So much so that Abimelech was very troubled. And word got to him that citizens of Shechem that made him king now became his enemies. And to cut the long story short, I would like to spare you the details. You go back this afternoon to read what happened. And Abimelech had trouble. And there are a few leaders that revolted against him. And then his right-hand man. What is his right-hand man's name? Zubel, his deputy. Informed Abimelech of this revolt. And they hatched a strategy to ambush the citizens of Shechem. And the leaders of Shechem, many of them were defeated resoundingly. And then that's not enough. Abimelech continued his cruelty and killed almost everybody in Shechem. And he continued his expedition against the Canaanite town. He gathered fire and burned the city of Shechem, and 1,000 men and women died. So therefore, the curse of Jotham was fulfilled. As you can see, this is the great controversy that is playing out. The Bible also talks about the king of the north and king of the south in Daniel chapter 11. You know, Daniel chapter 11 is the most difficult chapter of the whole Bible. Talking about the king of the north in detail, who are they? And king of the south, who are they? Playing out throughout history. King of the north sometimes win, king of the south sometimes won. And who are these king of the north? And who are these kings of the south? The king of the north represents false religious powers. Started with Babylon and ended in Rome. It means what? It means it's a religious political power, or truth mixed with error. As you can see in Abimelech, when he was king, he was born of an Israelite father, but then his mother was a Canaanite. So he worshipped the true God, at the same time worship Baal. And then King of the North represented counterfeited God's truth, and he substituted human commands for God's law. So the word of the king or the religious leader became supreme. So Abimelech had the honor of Gideon, but then have the adultery of his mother, a Canaanite woman. So the king of the north represents false religion, or truth mixed with error. So kings of the north mentioned in Daniel chapter 11 talks about false and true worship amalgamated together or joined together to persecute God's people. Then what about the king of the south? The king of the south represents Egypt, challenging the true God with words like of utter defiance, like, who is God that I should worship him? So these are people who are completely pagan, worshipping idols. And they represent all such rebellious, defiant, atheistic powers throughout the ages. And in Daniel chapter 11, it talks about this king of the north and king of the south fighting among each other. And therefore, Abimelech's army, which consists of the Israelites as well as Canaanite soldiers, fighting the citizens of Shechem that represents the Canaanites, and they fight among each other. And what about God's people? God's people are the remnant. Even though the whole Israel have apostatized, but God always preserve a remnant, a group of people who are always faithful to Him. 2 Samuel chapter 11 verse 21. It mentioned later on about Abimelech's downfall. What happened was, Abimelech was attacking one city. He asked his soldiers to gather firewood onto the fortress. Who killed Abimelech, son of Jerubbaal? Oh, this is another name for... Besheth is another name for Baal. Didn't a woman throw an upper millstone on him from the wall so that he died in Tebis? So Abimelech has been having victory after victory. But then, he was killed by a single stone thrown by a woman. And Abimelech said to his soldier, he says, "Please kill me. I don't want people to know that a woman killed me. It's not very glamorous. In fact, it's very shameful. He rather died by a man rather than by a woman." But throughout history, everybody know how he died. Okay, this story was related by King David. Didn't a woman throw an upper millstone on him from the wall and he died? You know, if a person is on the deathbed with the last breath, what would he do? I mean, what would you do? You probably ask God to forgive your sin. You probably make right with your enemies to make sure that you have a place in the kingdom, right? You probably give last words to those around you and say, "Please take care of my family. And this is my last testament, last will. Please do that." But what it was in Abimelech's mind? He was indeed a very cruel, self-centered king. It's all about himself. He killed his stepbrothers, 70 of them, minus one. And then just before he died, he says, "I want to preserve my reputation. I don't want to be killed by a woman." What kind of man is he? The Bible mentioned in Revelation 13 verse 3, "Then, and I saw one of the heads as if it has been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world marveled and followed the beast." So apparently, in the great controversy theme, Abimelech seems to fit the representation of the king of the north. But this king of the north, during his time, he received a mortal wound, right? He died. And later on, throughout ages, you have later on Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome, all play the role of the king of the north. I'm talking about the leaders. Today, we can see that the king of the north is creating unity among the Protestant churches. The threefold union of the Roman Catholicism, spiritualism, and apostate Protestantism. What about us as remnant believers of God? What should we do? The Bible tells us in Hebrews 10 verse 30 to 31 says, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay, and again the Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Now we have, when we have injustices done to us, the Bible reminded us not to take revenge, not to be vengeful. Leave it to God. Because if you do the wrong thing, God will punish us. And Abimelech met his deadly end. So were the citizens of Shechem. They met their deadly end as well. In fact, it was a power struggle among two parties who have left God. Romans chapter 12, verse 17 and 19 says, "Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge, I will repay,' says the Lord." Never be an instrument of the devil. But if you want to be an instrument of God, your duty is to pray for your enemies. Your duty is to love them. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. What do you mean by heaping burning coals on his head? To heap burning coals means it's a sign of repentance. Okay? You cause your enemy to repent not by giving him back what he deserves or punishing him back. Not through eye for an eye, not through tooth for a tooth. But by loving your enemies, by being kind to your enemies. And this is the conclusion. The last two verses of chapter 9. It spanned over 57 verses. It says, "Thus God repaid the wickedness that Abimelech had done to his father by murdering his 70 brothers. God also made the men of Shechem pay for all their wickedness. The curse of Jotham, the son of Jerubbaal, came upon them." This is the conclusion. What are we sowing today? Are we sowing good seeds? Or are we sowing evil seeds? Be careful, it will reap a harvest. You know what is the ending of the great controversy between good and evil? Good always triumph. God always triumph. Evil may seem to have an upper hand. You may seem to be suffering in the hands of your enemies. But then in the end, when you practice Christ-like character to love your enemies, you will triumph. So this is the conclusion. Abimelech slayed his brothers on a stone. Then later on a stone, crushed his head. He dug the grave for his enemies, but he fell into it. Abimelech dug his own grave. Right? He murdered his stepbrothers on a stone. And just in one stone, he was killed. Second, both the destruction of Shechem and the horrible death of Abimelech were just recompense for the atrocities perpetrated against Gideon's family. The curse of Jotham was realized when both Shechem and Abimelech were devoured, just as Jotham had predicted. You know, Satan, if he cannot destroy you from without, he will do it from within. In the past, the Christian church has been persecuted. And these persecutions are all external. But today, Satan is using friendly fire to attack the church. How? Through the spiritual decay from within. Because when God bless us, we become so contented. We begin to worship not the true God, but we worship money. We worship self. When we are in trouble, we run to God. When God bless us, we forgot to thank Him. And this is a spiritual decay from within. Second, infighting among brothers. Quarrels. The Bible never tells us to correct one another or make everybody think alike. The Bible says, bear with one another, forgive one another, right? Because there are certain things you cannot change on others. You can only change yourself. And C is what? C is spiritual complacency. Many of us live as if the devil is not around. But the devil is active. He is like a roaring lion, seeking whom he shall devour. Because he knows his time is short. God will allow his people to be chastened and reap the consequences of their sin. But God will not allow a tug like Abimelech to thwart his redemptive purposes. God always preserves a remnant. God always preserves a group of people who will be faithful to him. And this encouragement I want to share with you in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Don't you know that you yourself are God's temple? And that God's Spirit lives in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is sacred. You are that temple. You know, if we criticize our members, if we say evil words against one another, we are actually destroying God's temple. And God will promise, if you do that, God will destroy you. Because God's temple is made up of all of us. The church is us. Have you ever said that, hey, the church is not loving? Huh? The church is not doing this, it's not doing that. You are part of the church. You are part of this family of God. From now on, let us do the right thing to preserve God's temple, God's church. Let us edify it. Let us say words of rebuke with love and give affirmation when they do right. You know, how many of you have watched our Prime Minister's National Day rally speech? How many of you? Okay. Many of us who have watched the PM speech, and then later on he collapsed because of he stood too long, and he was probably dehydrated, and he fainted, right? And I sent to the WhatsApp group, the praying chat group, that we should pray. And later on, God answered our prayers, right? He revived. And then he made his speech shorter. And then he said, during one of the dialogue session, someone asked him, PM, sir, if God were to send an angel to give you 3 wishes, what would you wish for? Remember? How many of you remember? Okay, let's recap. Huh? He said he wished, the first wish is what? Singapore to be blessed with divine discontent. What is that? Always to be dissatisfied with where you are. Always driven to do better. Now, we can take these points and refer it to our spiritual life. That we should not be spiritually complacent. But to be closer and closer to Jesus, right? The reason why Israelites during the time of Abimelech, there was a downfall is because they were complacent. They were worshipping themselves. They forgot God. And what was the second wish? The second wish was Singaporeans would have wisdom to count our blessings. What is that? You know how precious Singapore is, and we know how to enjoy it and how to protect it. Many celebrities on the TV during the National Day celebration, many of them say, oh, I wish Singapore will be prosperous, peace, and so on. I concur with our PM. I wish all Singaporeans will be contented with what they have. At the same time, strive to improve spiritually. And then cultivate a spirit of thanksgiving and gratitude. We are living in this world where people are not grateful. When was the last time you affirm our government leaders? Somebody wrote in the Facebook, I don't want to mention, for the last 5 days, the MRT was having trouble, right? And many of them got to school late, got to work late. And somebody put on the Facebook and said, wow, it's terrible. But what about many days where the MRT are smooth, right? Have you ever key in and thank the people at working for the MRT? Can you imagine those staff working in the MRT facing complaint? Do you think they can sleep well? What about the CEO of the MRT? He received nothing but complaint. Why don't we try something different? Why don't we write to them and thank them for the days where MRT has been running well? We cannot be worldly people doing worldly things. We must be like Jesus doing godly things. I'd like to read to you this quotation from Sons and Daughters of God. It is not in the screen, but if you have a WhatsApp on Ellen White, you can turn to it. But if you don't have, please listen. I'd like to share this with you. Those professed Christians who are constantly complaining, who seem to think happiness and a cheerful countenance is a sin, have not the genuine attributes of religion. Those who look upon nature's beautiful scenery as they would upon a dead picture, who choose to look at dead leaves rather than to gather beautiful flowers, who take a mournful pleasure in all that is melancholy in language spoken to them by the natural world, who sees no beauty in the valleys clothed in living green, and grand mountain heights clothed the verdure, who close their senses to the joyful voice that speaks to them in nature, these are not in Christ. Okay? Suppose we change this order of things. Suppose you try to count all your blessings. You have thought so little of them, and they have been so continual that when reverses or affliction comes, you are grieved and you think God is unjust. You do not call to mind how little gratitude you have manifested for all the blessings of God. You have not deserved them. But because they have flowed in upon you day by day, year by year, You have looked upon them as a matter of course, thinking that it is your right to receive every advantage and give nothing in return. The blessings of God are more than the hairs on our head, more than the sands on the seashore. Meditate upon His love and care for us, and may it inspire you with love that trials cannot interrupt or afflictions quench. If we could only see the many dangers from which we are daily preserved by the holy angels, instead of complaining of our trials and misfortune, we would talk continually of the mercies of God. Amen? This passage cannot be overemphasized. Do you know that if we do not cultivate a spirit of gratitude now, when we go to heaven, it will be miserable because you're not allowed to complain in heaven. We're going to praise God day in and day out. We might as well get used to praising now. Otherwise, we will be miserable praising God throughout eternity. Can't complain. The church has many enemies within and without. But the church has one foundation, that is in Jesus Christ. And if we build our faith on this solid rock, no matter what happens, we will never move. Amen? Let's all stand. As we sing this song, the church has one foundation. God, our Heavenly Father, this morning, this afternoon, we want to confess and repent of our waywardness, of our self-centeredness, and failure to see your guiding hand in our lives. Forgive us for the many moments we complain against one another. We complain about almost everything in life that is not smooth. We want to repent of that. Lord, may you bless us with a divine discontent with our spiritual walk, that we will always strive to do better. May we be blessed with the wisdom from above to appreciate the things that you have given us. May we be blessed daily with the spirit of gratitude to thank you for all the mercies and protection that you have given us. And bless us until the day of your Son's coming to bring us all to heaven and the heaven make new. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Have a happy Sabbath.